Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always.
Amen. 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 Yeah, we are talking about sexual relationship. And some people, as my husband has said, they have demonized this gift. They have demonized it, and this is something that is not even taught in church. This is something that when some people mention it, they have rebranded sexual relationship, or when it comes to sex intimacy, it has been painted and it has been given names. And it is the thing that is being abused day and night. Everywhere across the globe, this is something that is being abused. And when it comes to believers, they have separated themselves. They have set themselves apart. And they see this is a demonic thing. So they are not seeking, or they are not looking for the divine way or divine understanding. And this is where many people have just gotten lost, and they don't understand what to do. And they don't understand how to go about it. But if you read the word of God, God introduced sexual relationship. Immediately when he created man and woman. If you read in the book of Genesis chapter number 1, I will just read so that someone will get to understand, so that the Lord will open up your inner eyes. Verse 27 says, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. So the plan of God, he created them. And he created them in his own image. Male and female. Manifestation or the process of manifestation was different. But he created them. The same time, male and female. Verse 28, this is now where God introduces something concerning the creature, man and woman, that he created. He's saying, then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every creeping thing that moves on the earth. So this is where the intention of God between the relationship of a man and a woman was introduced. You cannot be fruitful. You cannot multiply without having a union. You can't. So it is biblical, and it is in order for man and a woman to have a sexual relationship. And God has given directives. And that is why we said that when it comes to sexual relationship, it is something that should be taken with honor. This is something that is holy. It is like a sacrament. And we said when it comes to sexual relationship, it is, we can call it lovemaking. And this is a fellowship where a man and a woman, and of course, a husband and wife, because sex outside marriage, it is a curse.
Mm.
And when you do it before marriage, it attracts a curse. When you do it outside marriage, it attracts a curse. So sex is only blessed by God when it is in between a husband and wife. So it is something that should be taken with a lot of weight, of course, and with a lot of honor. And that is why we say it institutes. It is something that shows the fellowship between a husband and wife, which is in relation like a church and Christ when it comes to worship. And we were summarizing yesterday here the things that are required in a service.
Mm.
And we said in a service, there is praise. In a service, there is worship. In a service, there is adoration. In a service, there is sacrifice, that is giving. In a service, there is the session of the word. In a service, there is prayer. In a service, there is the conclusion with the word of grace.
Mm.
And if those things misses in a service, that service is not complete. And now, because we have taken sexual relationship outside from God, this is where even that something that should make people comfortable and enjoy.
Mm.
There are men who are dying.
Yeah.
We have seen even over the social media, men who are dying because they
want to look for power.
They want to strengthen themselves as men. They want to take some drugs to make them heroes. And at the end of it all, they are dying.
Mm.
And sex should not be a killing thing. Mm. But there are people who have died. Because when something is misused and it's abused, it is not blessed.
Yeah.
So please prepare tonight, because we want to know, why is sexual relationship important in a marriage? And of course, in a divine way and in a biblical way, we are going to discuss these things in details. And I believe God is going to bless us. You are doing it just casually, maybe the way the heathens are doing, maybe the way you have heard from some people even who do not know God. Please listen to this and you'll be a fulfilled person, and you are going to be happy and you're going to enjoy. God bless you.
Thank you very much. Amen. And God bless you for that wonderful session. We want to remind you something as we continue on this or with this discussion. Godly or a biblical reason for marriage. This will help you a lot to get in line with what we are discussing tonight. And we want to give you a quick recap, because we have given you this in our previous programs, but it's necessary for revision so that somebody will understand. Godly or biblical reasons for marriage. There might be other reasons why people have established marriage, but this is the reasons for marriage. Number one is to take away loneliness. We understand it in Genesis 2:18. It is not good for this man to stay alone. Loneliness is not supposed to be there. Then number two is to have a helpmeet. Somebody who is a life companion. Somebody who is going to work with you in life and to help you to achieve your dreams. That is gotten also in the same line of Genesis chapter 2:18. Then number three, that's why I'm coming now with this so that we understand more, is to take care of sexual need and avoid fornication. To take care of sexual need and avoid fornication. That's a reason for marriage. And marriage is only the institution that God has allowed the gift of sex to be practiced. Outside marriage is a curse. Before or even when you're married, but you go out to another partner. And this is gotten in 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. I want you to help me quickly. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1 and 2, so that we read. And before she opened that verse, because of time, I want you to go to point number 4, why God created marriage, or the godly way of marriage is for procreation or recreation. You can call it procreation or reproduction. Procreation or reproduction is a way of bearing children. So the children are brought up in the context of marriage. And those are the four major reasons why God allowed marriage to be there. And then God went and gave us that pattern, the type of marriage that we want. How does he want it?
Mm.
Number one is one man, one woman. And it's in Genesis 2, verse 22. One man, one woman. And then it is living and cleaving. A man shall leave his father and mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and shall become one flesh. That is Genesis 2:24. And then for companionship, that you have third person to have a companionship. And we get it in Genesis again, 2:18. And then this is for also openness or oneness. You become one and they are open. There's no privacy. There is no security. There is no barrier between the two. There's no secrets between the two of you. And it is gotten in Genesis 2:25. They were both naked and they were not ashamed. That kind of openness, that's the type of marriage. So if there is a shame between the couple, there is something wrong. If that marriage is not in God's design. And then number five is sex and reproduction. Sex and reproduction. So you can see again, God now ordained sex and reproduction in marriage. That's the type we wanted. So you cannot have a marriage where sex is not involved. That you say this is God's design. God said we marry, but we don't have sex between the two of us. That is not God. It's something else. So the design of God is, I have said five things. Then the type of marriage that God ordained, I have said four things. And you see all those things, sex is involved in the God's agenda. Mm-hmm. So sex in marriage is God's agenda. It's not created by devil, though devil has perverted it and has made many ugly things happen and many bad things come as a result of this, and many have abused it, and it's become something that looks terrible before the sight of men. You can read us now the scripture so that they say they understand what the Bible says in Corinthians 7, 1 and 2.
Yeah, 1 Corinthians chapter number 7, verse 1 and 2.
Yeah.
The one says principles of marriage. Yeah. That's the subtopic. Mm. Now concerning the things of which you wrote to me.
Uh-huh.
It is good for a man not to touch a woman. It is good for a man not to touch a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, because of sexual immorality,
mm-hmm.
let each man have his own wife,
mm-hmm.
and let each woman have her own husband.
Because of what? Sexual immorality.
Yes.
Let each man have his own wife, and let each wife have her own husband. So it's to take away that portion of scripture tells us God did not want people to have those sexual sins, and therefore he designed that and he gave us that way. Now, I want you to understand now, we said there are eight reasons why God created sex in marriage. And we will start, number one is for procreation. That's where we have seen now, it has been mentioned on. Number two, we said is for intimate. It's for intimate. And number three, we said sex is for knowledge. Number four is for pleasure. Number five, defense. Number six, comfort. And number seven, healing. And number eight, duty to God. Understand those things now. Now we are coming now to discuss point by point. And we start with point number one. Reason for sex in marriage. Number one, procreation. Procreation. Now, God's idea for sex and marriage in marriage, one of them was for procreation. So, procreation is supposed to be done within the context of marriage. Procreation is supposed to be done in the context of marriage. So, sex and reproduction outside the context of marriage lead to all kinds of problems. Now, that's where problems now begins. Sex and reproduction also outside the context of marriage leads to so many problems. So I want you to get this very well. So reproduction is supposed to be done within marriage. So you are not supposed to have children that you have brought up outside marriage. Outside marriage. So you want to have a child, you must first of all marry. This condition, number one, you are supposed to marry. You cannot say, I have children, but I don't want to get married. That's wrong. You are moving away from God's idea. That child you are bringing up needs care of the father, needs care of the mother. You as a mother, you are not able to bring up a child and make him complete. It doesn't matter how rich you are. It doesn't matter how talented you are, how educated you are. The child means the presence of the father, means the authority of the father. And when you look at this issue, you will understand clearly. No one was created by God to raise a child single-handedly. It's unfortunate.
Now, before you continue, because this is something sensitive that you're introducing here. In the society, especially even where we are right now, I've seen something happening. It is something that we are trying to rectify. We are trying to teach people. When a girl reaches 20 years, everyone begins to just show this girl or this lady, you should have a child.
A child.
And
look for a seed.
I was coming there, and this person now, she's corrupted, that she should give birth as early as from 20. And if I've met also with some ladies, you meet with a woman, she has four kids, different fathers, and when you try to talk to her, she will tell you, I am still looking for another seed, and you wonder why this kind of setup. As you are saying now, when you have a child outside marriage, we can see also in Psalm 51, David is praying a prayer of repentance. And this is as a result of the sin that he committed with Bathsheba.
I was coming there.
So verse 5 is saying, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Now, as you speak on this, because of what is happening in the society, and the children that are born outside marriage, what are the challenges?
There are so many challenges that are coming. That's why I have come, wanted to come and explain. And this is among the problems that is now being created by reproduction outside marriage. And one of the challenges that we get when reproduction has been done outside marriage, we have what we call step homes. We have step children, and we may have any other problem. Now, for example, the people who get engaged in sexual activities are reproduced before they get married. Some get lucky to get married by somebody who has understanding and can take care of the child. But I want to tell you, as I speak now, big percentage of people who have children before marriage, they are suffering a lot because they want the child to be accommodated. There are some who have ended up expelling their own children in the expense of their own happiness. And we have counseled many people, even grown up now, who have been wounded by their own mother before, when the mother now found love, trying to exclude her out. We have seen so many ladies also who got children before they got married. They are getting it rough to enjoy that marriage because maybe somewhere something has happened. This man does not appreciate again the kind of a child that you got, and he's not comfortable in raising. Sometimes they promise they will do that, and later in life things begin to change.
So a woman is divided.
The woman is divided now between these children that I have sired outside this marriage and this marriage. And some may hood their own children because they will choose happiness, especially if this man has shown you love and the child is acting. We have seen so many saying, my mother said, I cannot stand between her and marriage. I have to choose. We have seen those ladies also being abused by their own stepfathers.
Yeah.
They have been made mistresses in families. Because now the mother cannot protect them because already they are coming between him and the husband. We have seen people who have stayed in marriage as long as 17 years And things have started to crack because of the stepchildren. The stepchildren. So stepchildren, either you got them before marriage or you get them after marriage, they bring issues. They bring issues. That is why we say God's idea was this, that you have children within the context of marriage. So those who are advocating that you get a child outside, then you wait for another man to come and marry you, that culture is not good. It's making many people live with wounds, and it's making many people suffer a lot in life. So the idea of God is this: a child is supposed to be raised by a father and a mother. And this is solving a lot of problems when a child is raised by a father and mother. We understand. Somebody was talking to us today about a survey that has been recently released that 95% of people, men in prison in U.S., they were not raised by their fathers.
Yeah.
And then 65% of them also in prison again, they are people who are brought up by single parent. You can see now, ladies and gentlemen, you can understand that the impact that is created when a couple is united in raising up a child. It doesn't matter how much you have. A mother will always be a mother. She cannot be a father. A father will always be a father. He can never be a mother. So we want you to understand that the family is supposed to be together, father and mother. And that's how God ordained it, that the children are supposed to be born in the family and raised in the context of the family. So we don't advocate that you go out, get a child, and then wait to get married. No, even if marriage delays, wait. But accidentally, maybe you, out of ignorance, you went out and you got a child out of ignorance. Or you got a child and you were expected to get married. The one who was supposed to marry you accidentally either died or left you because of other issues. Still, there is grace. God can help you. But I want to tell you, don't enter that line thinking there is grace.
Yeah.
Thinking there is grace. Because you may not be as lucky as so-and-so whom got married and this person was ready to love them with their children. We have seen percentage of many people suffering. Why do you have to enter into that line when you know that there are some people who are suffering? There are some people who are going through hard times. Avoid it, because it's not a clean way for you. It's not a smart way for you. You can easily avoid it. But if it happened accidentally, don't write yourself off and say that I will not be happy, I will not get. No, there is God's grace that is sufficient, that can help you, and you can rise above and again be happy. So we say reproduction outside, or sex and reproduction outside the context of marriage, leads to all kinds of problems. Number one, we are saying step homes.
Mm-hmm.
There are people who are forced now to have a step home. You never wanted this, but you have a step home. You are taking care for somebody else that you sired, and you are paying bill. You may not be wanted to marry that lady, but you still have a responsibility. You have a son, you have a daughter somewhere. So you have a step home. And your attention is divided. Even if your aunt promised to raise a child for you and you are married, your attention still, you remember your child. You wouldn't like to do. And the child would be wounded. And that's why did you deliver me there? I have seen some have tried to cancel when their mothers gave them to be raised up by others. See, why should my mother give me to be raised by another? Why? She got me and she gave me. These are mother's wounds. Their fathers, and they injure a lot when it comes to marriage. Number two, their stepchildren also. Stepchildren who get those and move them. They cause problems, as I have explained. So you are not supposed to have sex outside marriage, because reproduction is only in God ordained it in the context of marriage. So when you sigh outside, that becomes another problem. Then there are other things that happen also. And like a punishment, there is what we call sexual transmitted diseases.
Yeah.
So you have sex outside marriage, and you have several partners. There is a possibility of having sexual transmitted diseases. And when you have them, you're not comfortable. There are things, there are signs showing that this is wrong. When you see there is sex transmitted disease, it means God is speaking a message saying, this thing is not supposed to be done just anyhowly.
Yeah.
You can get a disease. You can get a disease because you are doing it with the wrong people. You are doing it with the wrong people. Somebody say, what if I did with my husband? I got it. I got a sexual transmitted disease. How did the husband get it? That's the question you need to ask. That means he became unfaithful. He did something and now punishes you because you are in the same union. If the husband is dead without doing that, you would all be safe. Mm-hmm. So it means that when you step out and begin to do this, there is a punishment that will come. Sexual transmitted diseases are writing some people off. There are some people got even problems of getting children before even they got married because they were attacked even before then. So this is what is causing a lot of problem. This also may cause, apart from sexual transmitted diseases, may cause even murder. You realize that you are conceived and you don't want the child. What do? Some will advocate for abortion. They want to eliminate so that you stay that. There are so many people who are risking their lives in abortion. And there are so many people who are advocating now. They are trying their level best to advocate for abortion and say, this is just something that has come into the womb and you can wash it, we can flush it. It's not life. The Bible says life begins long before conception. So where in the womb? You are a human being. Then that's why God told Jeremiah, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I consecrated you.
Yeah.
So life begins long before the formation of the womb. Mm-hmm. So once this person has been formed in the womb, it's a confirmation that life is being formed. So the person that has been formed there is a human being and need to be protected according to God's honor. So there's some people say, no, this is not a child, let's flash, let's do this. We were looking at a situation and we have testified in this program. One of our sons, our daughter walks to hospital. She's as conceived and the doctor says, this baby is not growing, it's not a baby, let us flash. Let us wash because and you become free because this is not a normal pregnancy. In fact, it was not normal because it was a prophecy. And right now the child is there and growing. And the doctor said, let us flush. So there are so many people who did abortion. I remember I was praying for a lady who could not sleep at night because she had done, it was how many abortions? There were 12 or 9?
There were 12.
There were 12 abortions, and every time she would stand at night, 12 babies would surround her and start
when
crying.
When she
goes to sleep, yeah. And they would start crying and say, "Mommy, why did you kill us?" And in heaven, even some of you will meet with them, and they will tell you, "Although you did not allow us to live, God gave us this grace, and we are here, and this is how we would have been." So please, this is wrong, and it happens. Why? Because men have gone out to have sexual relationship outside marriage. So it leads also to more sins, apart from sexual transmitted diseases, apart from sexual immorality sin itself. There are sins like murder, destroying. There are some people who cannot father anymore, who cannot also mother, become mothers because they destroy their own homes as a process of that. And they are wounded. They are not happy. Yeah. It happened because they went outside the marriage and outside the plan of God. Sexual sin also, or sex and reproduction outside marriage also will also cause a lot of distraction in destinies.